Open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 11. Hey.
How you doing?
I'm pretty good.
I'm good.
I'm sorry, we haven't met. My name is Mike.
David.
David.
Right. Daniel.
Nice to meet you.
And Daniel also.
Daniel, yeah.
Well, good to be here with you folks. I've heard about this. Mike Lazio.
I
told him, I'd like to drop, but he's not here today.
He's not here today.
He does that once in a while.
That's okay.
He just jokes himself.
Praise God.
We went to Calvary back in.
I thought I recognized you.
I used to go there.
In 89 95.
Yeah, I thought I recognized you because we used to go there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah. That's a story I have.
That's okay. We all got our stories from there. Okay. All right. Matthew chapter 11. Now in Matthew chapter 10, we've got a bunch of Jesus basically commands and instructions as he sends out the 12. And he's sending them out and he gives them specific instructions at that specific time. And it's not a pattern for the way ministry is supposed to go on, because we see Paul didn't follow this and the apostles didn't follow this. But this was a specific place as he is sending out his apostles. He calls them apostles and he's sending them out two by two, and they're going to various villages and cities, and they're basically making the way for Jesus to then be in their town. And so as we went through basically what it means to be a disciple and the fact that they are going to be paid to do their work and supported by God himself, and God's going to use the generous hands of those who they're going to come into contact with. And it's not about trying to make money in the flesh. It's about you're going to trust God to take the next step. And so it was a specific thing, and that was changed later. But this was a certain time. Jesus is letting them know it's not going to be easy. He says, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves. He says, be as wise as serpents, but be as gentle as doves. Basically, a serpent is wise. They get big and huge only because they know where the good hiding places are. Because everybody can eat a snake. I mean, you know, you got roadrunners and coyotes and you name it, they'll all eat snakes. Raptors, they'll come down and grab a snake. I mean, everybody eats snakes. But the big ones know the right place to hide. The big ones know how to find their food and grab it. And being as harmless as a dove means if you watch the way doves eat, they'll get out of the way of something that's a little bit more aggressive. They're going to trust the Lord's going to take care of them and go ahead, eat whatever you want, and whenever you're done, I'll come and have what God wants me to eat. I mean, doves are that way. Now, I've seen doves scrap with each other, but, you know, usually they're not getting in the way of anybody else. Be that harmless. And that's how we are to share the gospel. It's not about being militant and trying to have some big force or intimidating or manipulating people to try to accept God's word or something. No, you nowhere to hide. You hide in the rock, Jesus Christ. And you allow God to take care of you. And he says, it's not like you've got nothing coming. He says, it's going to be a reward. And at the end of chapter 10, he says, you know, any kind of reward. God's not going to forget anything. Even something as insignificant as a cup of cold water. You're not going to lose your reward. Something that a little child could do. God's never going to forget that. We talked about that last week. And then basically, verse 1 of chapter 11 continues on with, you know, the numbers and the chapters of the verses are not inspired. That showed up later. They made a system so that you could easily get to a certain spot in the Bible. So basically, verse 1 of chapter 11 continues on with the same thing. Chapter 11, and it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. So Jesus then came and followed behind where the apostles had prepared the way. So he was training his apostles on how to share the word, how to proclaim the truth, how to be good shepherds. He gave them power to cast out demons and to heal the sick and to raise the dead and to cleanse the lepers. I mean, they did what he came to do. He gave them that kind of power. And then Jesus came, and they got to see the reality of the message that the apostles were preaching. Verse 2, chapter 11. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples, and said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, the poor have the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, What went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what went ye out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if ye will receive it, this is Elias, which was for to come. And he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets, and calling unto their fellows, and saying, We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, He hath a devil. And the Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, Behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. Then began he to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee have been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. But I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. Dear Father, we ask that you give us understanding by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we want to understand your word. But Lord, we also ask for the power of your Holy Spirit to change our hearts and to give us your thoughts to think. And let our behaviors and our reactions and our responses be what displays you to everybody we come into contact with, dear God. Lord, change our lives. Lord, let us never be the same again after hearing your word. Let us be completely different, dear Lord. Transformed into your image, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Verse 2 of chapter 11. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples, and they said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached unto them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. So now we see a situation that's been going on. John the Baptist is in prison. He's in the prison that belonged to Herod, and it's Macarius prison, however you say it, prison. And it's an ugly, nasty place. And what had happened is Herod had visited his brother in Rome, basically, and fell in lust with his brother's wife and seduced her and said, "Hey, you want to be my queen and come to, you know, Israel with me and we can reign together," or whatever the case may be. And he took his brother's wife. I mean, it's pretty sick. I mean, we're not talking, I mean, and his title is the King of the Jews. I mean, just as, you know, Herod the Great was called King of the, but they're not Jews. They're Idumeans. They're not even Jewish. But because they're from, you know, they're Semitic people, you know, Caesar says, sure. If you got enough money, you can be king of whatever you want. I mean, that's how it worked back then, because Rome is in charge. So he had a big, large chunk to rule, which ended up being Galilee and other places in the north. It wasn't in Judea, but it was farther north. That's why when Jesus was being put in trial, you know, there's the Roman governor of Judea, that's Pontius Pilate. He says, "Oh, you're from Galilee. I'm just going to send," you know, he wanted to get rid of Jesus. There's nothing wrong, and all the Jews are, you know, they want him to kill and they can't do nothing. He says, "Okay, I'm going to get him out of my hands. I'm going to send him to Herod, because that's his jurisdiction anyway. He just happens to be here for the feast anyway." See, that's how things worked. It's all politics. It had nothing to do with real religion, a real relationship with God. These people were all secular, agnostic at best. Well, here's Herod. And obviously his wife wasn't too pleased with the fact that John the Baptist, this prophet in the Judean wilderness, is calling her prostitute or an adulteress or whatever. I mean, whose wife is going to want some, you know, religious leader coming up with that kind of stuff? She wasn't very happy with John the Baptist. So what's Herod going to do? What's Herod going to do? Well, you know, if mom's not happy, ain't nobody happy, so we're going to put him in prison. So John's in prison. And Herod liked to hear John. I mean, this guy was great. I mean, people just go to see somebody who's on fire, you know, they're just going to listen. They don't care. I mean, this is amazing. This guy's just calling out everything bad, and he doesn't care. And he doesn't even care the fact that he's in prison. And John still has disciples. Now, I have to say a little bit about John the Baptist. This is really an amazing man. And we know that from other places in the scriptures. Because we see the Apostle Paul. Now, when did he get saved? Well, this was probably, you know, 20 years or so after the resurrection of Jesus. I mean, I don't know when he got saved, but it was, remember, he was there still not believing in Jesus, and, you know, all the other Jewish leaders there were putting the clothes at his feet as they were picking up stones to stone Stephen. So finally, God stopped him in his tracks on the way to Damascus. But as after he gets saved, and remember, there's some time he doesn't go meet with the apostles. You know, he gets saved and he's in Damascus, and they have to let him out of a window. As soon as he gets saved, he's just totally on fire, and he's, things were peaceful in Damascus. It was nice being a Christian in Damascus. Nobody gave you any trouble. You're kind of away from most of the problems there in Judea. But not when this guy Saul shows up and he realizes that Jesus is Messiah, and he's just shaking the cages. I mean, the whole place is in turmoil. So all of a sudden they got to let him down through this little through a little rope net. They got to let him through a window in the city because they're going to try to kill him. Because he knows. He got saved. He knows Jesus is Messiah. And now Damascus is terrible. Now if you're a Christian, you're going to be persecuted. I mean, everything all of a sudden got really bad. Because the truth is being proclaimed. Well, it was at least 7 more years. It says he was 7 years in Arabia. What does that mean? He was getting taught by Jesus himself. So it was at least that much time. And another 3 years. So we don't know when it was. Now, add that to the time of Jesus' ministry from when John the Baptist first started preaching, and now finally, you know, Paul is doing some missionary journeys. And he gets into Ephesus. and he finds some folks who were baptized with John's baptism. That's all they knew. They were baptized for the repentance of sins. And they were still looking for Messiah to come. I don't know that they even understood that Jesus had done everything. Now, this is a long-lasting influence. Well, that teaching that was never connected with the real evidence is Jesus Messiah suffering for the sins and then rising from the dead and so on, that continued. And so there were still, beyond that point, 100 years later, there was still places that were teaching repentance and John's baptism. And then historically. I mean, this man, if you look at the time when he started his ministry to the time that he was thrown in prison, he had a 6-month ministry. And in that period of time, he never did any miracles. He just preached repentance. And people knew that God was real and was going to hold them accountable, and they know that they need to repent right now because the kingdom of heaven is going to come and God is going to come and send Messiah, and there's going to be hell to pay. He's coming with his refining fire. He's coming with his winnowing fork. It means that you're going to be sifted and you're going to be burned if you don't repent. I mean, this is some scary stuff. People were coming all over the place to hear John the Baptist preach. He preached for 6 months. That was it. He was thrown in prison. And he had a ministry that extended beyond that. Now that's powerful. 6 month ministry. Wow. He prepared the way of Messiah. Did a really good job. So as far as those guys in Ephesus, Paul says, He made things clear to them. He showed them who Messiah was and everything Jesus did. And then he baptized them in Jesus' name. And then they didn't even know there was the Holy Spirit, and he had to place his hands on them to receive the Holy Spirit, and they spoke in tongues. I mean, they were clueless because that's all the information they had. But because they were faithful to the truth that they knew, God wasn't going to let them abandon them because they didn't know anymore. God's going to send the Apostle Paul to talk to them. That's how good God is. Anyway, all that to say, this is an amazing man. So where he was at this time, he was in prison. He still had his head at this point. And that doesn't happen till later when he loses his head. Where, you know, Herod's wife knows Herod really well. Knows the sick kind of stuff that he's into. So she gets her own daughter to dance a hoochie-coochie dance in front of Herod and all his buddies. And they get all excited, and Herod says, "Hey, I'll give you half my kingdom. What do you want?" And she goes over to her mom and says, "Hey, what do I ask for? This is amazing. I want John the Baptist's head on a platter." Ooh. So she goes over there, tells him, and because he made this oath in front of everybody, everybody's been drinking, all excited, you know, here's a striptease artist, and that's his own, you know, his stepdaughter there. I mean, this is sick. We're talking sick. There's nothing nice about this. This is the way humanity has always gone. When it's all left to itself to do all what it wants to do, it always ends up in the worst possible, nastiest sin that there is. So they chopped his head off and they brought the head in and everything was done. Well, here, John hadn't been beheaded yet. He was still in prison. But to backtrack a little bit, I want to go to the book of John chapter 1. Because here, in John chapter 1, we see John's account of who John the Baptist is. Okay, in John 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth not. Now the first thing John talks about, because he was a disciple of John the Baptist, he's going to talk about who John the Baptist was. Because that's how influential this man was. He's all a part of salvation history. And there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came not unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of men, but of God. And the Word was made flesh and dwell among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now back to John again, verse 15. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And this is the record of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? He confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Art thou Elias? And he said, I am not. Art thou that prophet? And he answered, no. Then he said unto him, who art thou? That we may give an answer to them that sent us. What sayest thou of thyself? And he said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said by the prophet Isaiah. That's Isaiah 40, verse 3. And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him, and said unto him, why baptize thou then, if thou be not the Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet? John answered them, saying, I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom ye know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore I am come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode on him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bare record that this is the Son of God. And again the next day, after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walks, he saith, behold the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. One of those two disciples was John. That's James and John. Those are the two disciples. That was John. This is John's personal testimony. He was a disciple of John the Baptist, and John the Baptist pointed to Jesus, the Lamb of God, and he said, behold the Lamb of God. Then Jesus turned and said, saw them following, and saith unto them, what seek ye? They said unto him, Rabbi, which is translated, which to say being translated master or teacher, where dwellest thou? He saith unto them, come and see. They came and saw where he dwelt and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. And one of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon, said unto him, we have found Messiah, which is being interpreted to Christ. And he brought him to Jesus, and Jesus beheld him. He said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is interpreted a stone. So, then we have the calling of the next couple of apostles, disciples. Okay, this is John's own testimony of who Jesus Christ is. This is John sending his disciples to become disciples of Jesus Christ. John said later, I must decrease, he must increase. Okay? I want to set this truth down first before we start talking about what's going on right here in the text of Matthew 11. John sends two disciples to Christ, to Messiah. Notice the way he says that. He doesn't say to Jesus. He says, now when John heard in the prison the works of Christ, he heard the works of Messiah. That's what Christ is. Christ is Greek for Messiah, which is Hebrew. He sent two of his disciples and said unto them, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Did John the Baptist know that Jesus was Messiah? Yes. Is John doing anything? No, he's sitting there in prison, but what is he doing in prison? He's continuing to disciple. If anybody's ever taken any courses in teaching kids, what is the greatest way to get a child to learn? Discovery. Every kid, all of a sudden, is infatuated with learning the moment they have experienced discovery. John the Baptist sent his two disciples to Christ, to Messiah. He says, I want you to ask him this question. Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? John's days are limited. He's not in Bethabara baptizing people because there's a bunch of water there anymore. He has done what he has come to do. And what is left within his realm of ministry is continuing to disciple those who God has sent him to disciple. And he's sending these two to go talk to Messiah. Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John those things which ye do hear and see. Hear and see. What is that? It's discovery. It is exactly how we learn as human beings. Go and tell John. What did you just see? Go and tell John the words that you just heard. Now, in the parallel account in Luke, during this period of time, Jesus was healing people and teaching people. They were right there when they saw the lepers cleansed. They were right there when they saw the deaf give hearing. They were right there when they saw the lame healed. And it wasn't some stupid circus up on a stage somewhere where they're pulling somebody out of a wheelchair and he gets up all crippled and he stands up. It's not some kind of contortionist thing that all of a sudden pulls all of his joints back in place. Now, this is the real deal. This is people who have shriveled limbs that you know, like this child about a month ago. Instead of trying to work with that shriveled limb, he convinced the doctors, no, he'd rather just be without it because it was easier being without it than having to deal with this shriveled limb of his. That's the way life still is without Jesus' power to do what he's always done. It's better to cut it off and put something fake on than to try to deal with what doesn't work. Go and show John's. Go and tell John the things that you see and hear. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk. The lepers are cleansed. The deaf hear. The dead are raised up. And the poor have the gospel preached to them. These two disciples of John the Baptist got to see with their own eyes and got to hear with their own ears Jesus Christ, God the Son, Messiah, right in front of them. At this point in John's ministry, he's still got disciples. John has been pointing people to the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And the disciples' job is to turn people to Jesus. The disciple's job is to not build himself some kind of big kingdom and have all these people supporting his ministry and continuing his program. No, the disciple is to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. I mean, it's very easy for somebody who is a brand new Christian to come to you and they'll call you in the middle of the night and all those things are great. There's times when there's a baby Christian, and he just needs to know Jesus died on the cross for that sin, just like a baby when you got to change the diaper. There's times when a baby Christian's got to know that God is still there, and that's just like a mommy holding on when the child is upset or frustrated or afraid. There's a time when a baby Christian, you need to pick him up and teach him how to take the steps. And that's what we have to do. We have to help the baby Christians take the steps. And what does it take? Okay, call me up if you think you're going to, if you're being tempted to this sin that you're stuck in, call me and we'll walk this through with you. There's times when a baby Christian needs to be taught, okay, this is how you can, you don't have to suck the milk anymore. You can take the meat and you can cut it and you can stick the fork in it and you can put it in your mouth and you can chew it. Just like a mom has to wean their children off of their milk and start giving them solid food. There's a time when a baby Christian needs to, okay, we're going to show you how the toaster works. And we're going to put the bread in there, and when it comes up, now don't touch it because it's going to be really hot. And so you can take it out here and you can put the butter on it and the butter will melt. Here's the bowl, and here's where the cereal is, and we'll have it where you can reach it, and you can pour the cereal in, and you can pour the milk in there, and we're going to have the milk on a shelf where you can take it out of the fridge, and you can make your own breakfast. Wouldn't this be exciting? You don't have to have mommy do it, so you can do it yourself. Or you can have your own little kingdom, and everybody is addicted to you to answer every little thing. And we who are, you know, exhorters and really encourage each other, it's very easy to have people addicted to you. Because not only you can be in the flesh and tell them what they want to hear, but you can also be Jesus for them to the point where they never go to God Himself. And if you're not there, their whole life crumbles. John isn't doing that. He's growing his babies up. He's making them men. They're going to cut up that word for themselves. They're going to feed their own souls. But beyond being able to do this, there is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You go and see. Ask Him if He's the one to come or if there's somebody else. So Jesus says, go and tell John what you see and hear. Now, we've got to look up a couple of these passages that are what Jesus is completing that Messiah is supposed to do. Okay, Isaiah 29 is one of them. This is just a couple. I'm not going to do them all. There's a lot, but Isaiah has the really clear ones. So Isaiah 29, 18. And in that day shall the deaf hear the words of the book, and the eyes of the blind shall see out of obscurity and out of darkness. The meek also shall increase their joy in the Lord, and the poor among men shall rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. The Holy One of Israel. That's Messiah. Isaiah 29, 18 and 19. And then you can go over here to Isaiah 35. It's just a beautiful one. Isaiah 35, starting verse 5. The eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as an hart, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and the streams of the desert, and the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. And habitation of dragons where each lay shall be grass with reeds and rushes, and highway shall be there, a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring men, those fools shall not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any ravenous beast shall go up thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness and sorrow, and sighing shall flee away. These are just a couple of passages that are talking about Messiah to come. But it's talking about Messiah to come when He reigns on the throne of His father David. Just as Angel Gabriel told His mother Mary, that's what Jesus is going to do. Sit on the throne of His father David. Is that happening now? No. It's not happening now. All power and authority is given to Jesus Christ, but He's not sitting on the throne of His father David in Jerusalem. No, it's going to happen. It will absolutely happen. That promise is going to be kept. But before it's kept, the other things that John the Baptist said was going to happen are going to have to happen. Because when John the Baptist was preaching, he wasn't just preaching about these really wonderful, loving, caring, compassionate things, he's also saying that Messiah is going to come, and he's going to come with the winnowing fork in his hand. He's coming to baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And if you look at the context of what "and with fire" means, it's not talking about putting a passion for Jesus in your heart. It's talking about the fires of God's judgment. That's the baptism of fire that John the Baptist is speaking with, that Jesus Christ is going to do. And that's called the Great Tribulation, where this planet is going to get trashed. And all these tree huggers are going to have all their trees burned up. And all these folks who are trying to save the water, that water is going to be destroyed with, you know, wormwood's going to come down and wreck the water. All these whale lovers, that fiery mountain's going to come out of the sky and it's going to destroy a third of the sea. I mean, this is a whole lot of damage is going to go on. When the tribulation starts, there's going to be earthquakes greater than this world has ever known. And I say that because we've had plenty of earthquakes historically that have wrecked lots of stuff. But we haven't had those yet. Everything that comes is a judgment from Christ on a Christ-rejecting world is something that the world has never seen. That's how intense it's going to be. It hasn't started yet. I know some people want it to already have happened, but then they interpret everything that happens in the news as another evidence that tribulation has started. Well, when did it start? Well, there's all kinds of things that happen before the tribulation starts that are what? It's a shot over the bow. God's saying, hey, take me seriously. This is what's happening. Because when it happens, there's going to be no doubt about it. So all that to say, John the Baptist has been preaching judgment to come. And the judgment to come that he's preaching didn't make any friends. Because that judgment, as he is quoting from prophets like Malachi, is what Messiah is going to do to the apostate priesthood. It's going to be ugly. Well, that didn't happen. Now, Messiah is absolutely going to come. And all these wonderful things that we just read about in Isaiah 35 are going to happen. But that hasn't happened yet. Jesus came. But he had to leave. And he tells his disciples in John 14, I go away. I'm going away right now. But I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'm coming back to take you to be with me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places, or you could say many mansions, but it comes up with all kinds of wacko theology. But many dwelling places. There's plenty of room for my bride. I'm going to get my bride, and I'm going to take you to be with my Father's house, and you're going to be with me forever. There's going to be a resurrection. All the dead in Christ are going to be raised first, and we who are still here and living are going to be changed. In an instant and twinkling an eye. And when we see him, we'll be like him. When we see him as he is, there is going to be a resurrection when Jesus comes and takes us to be with him in his Father's house. And that happened to be pre-trib.
Amen.
And after that period of time, I believe then God's going to pour out his wrath on a Christ-rejecting world. We are in tribulation right now. That's what Jesus says. In this world, you're going to have tribulation. And that's what we're going through right now. But it's not the wrath of God. It's the wrath of the devil. The wrath of all those who are under his authority. Through much tribulation do you enter the kingdom of heaven. I mean, this is a horrible place that we live here. If anybody thinks that life is supposed to be great, you know, they've got the wrong expectations. It's not the one that Jesus has given us. No, he talks about persecution. This is what it means to be a disciple. And if they don't like you, if that house is not worthy, if they don't want to hear about who Jesus is, you shake off the dust of your feet. If that town won't hear the message, you shake off the dust of your feet. Just as though it's a Gentile town. And you move on to the next one. And that's how the Apostle Paul did his ministry. He stayed there until they rejected him to the point of just about killing him. And he dusted off he shook the dust off, and he went on to the next town. And in every single town, a church was planted. Sometimes he was only there for a couple of weeks, as we know from you know, he had to write a letter to the Thessalonians. He was only there a little bit of time. But in that period of time, he reminded them of some amazing deep theology that churches today don't want to talk about.
Yeah.
And that's where 1 Thessalonians 4 comes from, that we talked about in the first part of chapter 5.
Yeah, I went to see that movie yesterday, Persecuted.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a wake-up call for the nation.
Yeah.
And,
all over the world.
It's scenario, but on the other hand, it's dealing with real stuff.
Right.
How close we are. And
right.
How much Christians are beginning to be persecuted.
Well, that's just our country. You know, every other country, they've been horribly persecuted. I mean, there has, in the 20th century, that's just 100 years, there was more Christians killed for their faith than the rest of the previous 2,000 put together.
Given the warning to the Christians,
yeah.
and they gave it to them yesterday.
Yeah, so you convert and you pay a tax
right
or you
now,
die.
They're on their way out. If they're
right.
not on their way out, they're going to
right.
be killed.
Right.
So they're hidden out for...
And nobody wants them because they're surrounded by, you know, Muslim nations. I mean, it's sick. It's really sick. I mean, how many millions of Christians were killed in Sudan by the Muslims? I mean, it's horrible. How many Christians in China?
So if those people knew, I'm sure a lot of them thinking that they are in the Great Tribulation.
Oh. Right, right.
And they don't know the Bible like we should.
But, you know, Paul wrote to the Thessalonians because they thought they were in the tribulation and they thought they missed the rapture. He says, no, I don't want you to be uninformed, brethren. These troubles that are coming to you are coming. This is normal. And then so he had to tell them what the rapture was all about. What is the resurrection happening? What is that all about? Because they were thinking, oh, we missed it. And those people who died before us, they're going to miss it.
That's why we got to prepare ourselves. It could happen soon in this country.
Right. And it's happening. It's happening. So, anyway, all that to say, Jesus showed John's disciples, he proved to them that he is Messiah. Look what I'm doing. Hear what I'm saying. Isn't this what Messiah is supposed to do? Now, the second half of it, of him pouring out his wrath on those who reject him, that's not there. But the first half was there. So verse 6, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Blessed is he who shall not be offended in me. Well, I didn't do the last one. The poor have the gospel preached unto them. I go to Isaiah 66, verse 1, or Psalm 22, 26. But anyway, I'll just go on. Anyway, that's what's happening. Jesus didn't have, you know, just a certain, a certain group of people. No, he went to everybody.
Oh, demographic.
Demographic. He didn't have a certain demographic he was trying to reach. No, every single person, even the poor, those people who have no political power, who are always being taken advantage of, they know Jesus is their Messiah. They're the ones that come faster. They're the ones in need, and their need is fulfilled by Jesus. Okay, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Whosoever shall not be offended in me. Well, there were certain expectations that people had for Messiah. Obviously, the Jewish leadership and the Pharisees, they were looking for a Messiah who is going to destroy all their enemies. He's going to wipe out Rome. And one of Jesus' disciples was a Jewish terrorist, so to speak. He was a zealot. Now, I don't know how it was for him to be a disciple right next door to, you know, Matthew, who was a tax collector, who was, you know, in collusion with the Roman government. I mean, that's what God does. I don't care what your fullest extremes of political, you could be a Democrat and a Republican and sit next to each other and worship the Lord, and it's not going to make any difference. You know, or Green Party or whatever. It doesn't matter. Anyway, here is the two furthest extremes in the political way of looking at things. And they were both his disciples. Well, here is a zealot who was looking for Messiah. He's waiting for Messiah to come to destroy Israel's enemies. And he was willing to take matters into his own hands like every other zealot. But Christianity is not a religion of force. Whenever you see it come in force, it's religion as an excuse to kill people and take their stuff. But Jesus told Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it was of this world, then my servants would fight to keep me from being arrested."
We have spiritual force.
Yeah. Paul says that, you know, our enemies are not of the flesh. They're spiritual strongholds, powers and the authorities and principalities and so on. "Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." Jesus offended, caused to stumble the Pharisees. He wasn't schooled in their little rabbinical way of looking at things. He interpreted the Bible without quoting from any rabbi. That wasn't done. Who are you to be so much greater than all these guys whose writings we study and memorize? He offended them. He stumbled them. Here is Jesus, who is Messiah, and he's not doing anything to somehow eliminate the Roman Empire or to break free from their control. I mean, you got all these folks who got fed. When 5,000 men got fed. And then they went and looked for Jesus and they walked all the way around the Sea of Galilee because they heard he was over there. And you can see that in John chapter 6. They wanted a bread king. If you had somebody who would just miraculously feed you, and if anybody got injured in battle, you could, you know, not just bind a wound, but they'd be, you know, back up and running again with a sword in their hand. I mean, we got an invincible army here. That's not what Jesus came to do. And by the end of chapter, you know, 6 of John, all that's left is Jesus' personal disciples here. And Jesus says, "What, you're not going to leave too?" And of course Peter says, "To whom shall we go? You're the one who has the words of eternal life." You know, in this last election, we had these militant Christians trying to get all the Christians together as a big political power to have somebody who could represent them. But it wasn't a Christian who they wanted to represent them, unfortunately. But Billy Graham's association said, "Oh, no, Mormonism is just another sect of Christianity. No, go ahead and vote for him," in other words. Oh, brother, give me a break. If you don't believe that Jesus Christ is God the Son, you don't go to heaven.
Nothing but confusion.
Oh, it's crazy. And that's what they keep trying to do. They try to have, because there's still a majority of Christians. But if you'd have them as one voting bloc, oh boy, all their power and influence.
The dearest I think that ever came was the Ronald Reagan.
Right, right. Yeah.
We'll never see that again.
No. But, yeah, but what did Zechariah say to Zerubbabel? It's not by might, not by one great big strong man, not by power, not by an association and a large influence of lots of people, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. That's it. And we've got this crazy growth, you know, church growth movement that it's all about using business models to try to grow a church. And they can sell anything to anybody because they know the right philosophies and psychologies to get anybody to do anything. I mean, they've been studying folks' behavior and what they want to do and for years. So they just accept all this. And what happens? You can get yourself a gigantic church and people are doing it all over the place. And it works.
That was part of that movie yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry about that, Mike, because
right, all liars, that's right. They don't get to go in.
Sales and merchandising.
Right.
They rely on lies.
Right, absolutely. Absolutely. Because you don't want what they're selling because you don't have it. If you wanted it, you'd have bought it already. So they're trying to get you to do what you don't want to do. It's called manipulation. I mean, that's how this all works.
Yeah.
I mean, if you can share the gospel with somebody and use manipulation, and you can get them to accept Jesus in their heart, but they're of the same opinion still. They're still not going to heaven. They just got a get out of hell free card in their back pocket, and they think they're good to go. And you pat them on the head with the 1 John 5:13, and they think they're set. It's like they get people all excited. They have people getting rebaptized just to get the balls working, you know? So these people, oh, I wasn't ready to be baptized, but I really want to get baptized. And then all these people start going forward to get baptized. So you're manipulating people even to do the first thing that you're required to do once you get saved. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So what happens? It's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Oh, but we're getting God's work done. It's the end that justifies the means. It's pragmatism. No. Who's in charge of the ends? God is in charge of the ends. He's always been in charge of the ends. But he holds us accountable for the means that we use to do his work. And everybody's got to stand before him and answer. Once you throw God's word out the window, that is what's the majority, probably 75% if not 90% of Christianity. Because they don't believe the Bible is inspired. And then you've got those who throw the Holy Spirit out the window. By using man's methods to build the church, by using man's methods and intimidating and manipulating and to get anybody to do anything. So now what have you got as a pastor? You've got nothing to work with. If you've got God's Word and you got the Holy Spirit, this is where revival has always happened. So they come up with substitutes for the Holy Spirit. So they got all these crazy charismaniacs out there doing all this stuff, and it's familiar spirits, and it's kundalini power, and it's all these crazy things that come from Eastern religion because they don't have the Holy Spirit. And how do you know? Well, you can't judge. Can't you? Look at the fruits, Jesus says. Matthew chapter 7. When he says don't judge, he also says, look at the fruit. Do fig trees come off of thorn bushes? Do grapes come off of thistles? I don't think so. Look at the fruit. By the fruit you would know them. Look at the fruit of these guys who are doing all these crazy things and saying it's the Holy Spirit. Are they leaving their wives and going and shacking up with their girlfriend or with their homosexual lover? Or are they getting a divorce and marrying somebody else as they continue on with their ministry? Well then, what's the power behind their ministry? It hasn't been the Holy Spirit. Look at the fruit of their life. Well, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. There's all kinds of folks to this day, as we're talking about, who are offended by Jesus. They don't want to do things his way. His way is not flashy. His way has never brought any attention to a human being. His way has always made Jesus Christ famous. I mean, I got a problem with anybody who's got their name on the marquee of their church. I mean, you can go up there, follow Cave Creek Road, and you'll see one. It's not just Assembly of God Church. No, you got the guy's name on there.
Yeah.
And he's not the only one.
It, the sign just says Tommy Barnett.
Yes.
Tommy Barnett's. Assembly.
Yes. First Assembly. Yeah.
Or either have a ministry with the name.
Right.
Name of the guy and then,
right.
And then ministry.
Right.
Like,
right. Jesus. And I got a problem with that. You know, and the websites that have that pastor's name .com. I mean, how blatant is that? But you see it all over the place.
What's that?
You know, the name of the pastor whose stuff that is being sold, whose stuff is being hawked on their website, they got his name.com. Well, of course, that's exactly what it is. All that to say, blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. There's all kinds of people offended by Jesus because Jesus isn't meeting their expectations. Life isn't happening the way they want it, and Jesus isn't doing what they're expecting Jesus to finish off. Isaiah 35. I mean, who doesn't want the desert to be a well-watered garden? Well, when is that going to happen? When Messiah shows up after the battle of Armageddon, after he's come from Basra, and there's the blood of his enemies scattered on his clothing, and he says, I have trampled the winepress alone. He kills all of Israel's enemies that day, and he goes up the Mount of Olives, and it splits in two. he is?
Speaking of Michael.
Yeah. Okay.
Hello, okay. Well, hey, David, how are you? Well, I figured I better come because I know he was coming.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Hey,
so, 11:6, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Well, it's very easy because Jesus doesn't meet our expectations. Any of us can be offended because things aren't working out our way. Depending on whatever false theology you got brought up in, and we all have it, we all have our own false expectation, our own false systematic theology, and Jesus doesn't meet our expectations. Every last one of us has it. It would be nice if that wasn't the case, but it is the case. Otherwise, why are we moody? Why are we depressed? Why are we frustrated? Why are we angry? Because Jesus didn't meet our expectations. Well, where was John the Baptist? He was in prison. Is his faith shaken? I don't think so. I really don't think so. Otherwise, he wouldn't have sent his disciples to Christ, says right here. He sent them to Christ, to Messiah. That's what Christ means. He knows who Jesus is, but he wants to make sure his disciples are not addicted to him personally. They need to be addicted to Jesus Christ personally. That needs to be their obsession, Jesus Christ. Not himself, this prophet. Blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. When we are stumbled by God not meeting our expectations, is it God's fault? No, it's our expectations. It really is. I mean, God is set. He doesn't change. He doesn't have to make us happy. His job is to make us holy. And it's very easy to be offended in Jesus Christ. Because he's not going to make our lives super easy. No, he's the one who gave us the expectation through much tribulation, the end of the kingdom of heaven. In this world, you'll have tribulation, but behold, I have overcome the world. That's our expectation in Jesus Christ.
Mike, I'm kind of burdened by my son, especially by this verse, blessed are those who are not offended by me. After he left Calvary, just like around the college years, like you're talking
right.
about, he walked away from Jesus.
Right.
And anytime
right.
you talk about Jesus to him, it offends him.
Right. And that's and he's not the only one. He's not the just we'll keep praying for him.
Yes.
But he's not the only one. Because they were sold a bill of goods, a false bill of goods.
Yes.
And so life isn't working the way they were told in church.
Yes.
And all this stuff, you know, people come to church and they got itching ears. They want to hear what's going to make them feel good about themselves. And so what happens? If all you hear from the pulpit is something that you want to hear, when life is real and it's hard and it's nasty and you're abused and you're thrown down and you're kicked to the curb and you're stomped to pieces and you're going to say, God, don't you love me? Don't you care? How could you possibly let this happen to me? You don't care what I want? You don't care about my deepest desire? All I heard in church since I was little is that you care about my deepest desire. Yeah, he does care about your deepest desire, but he also cares about your holiness. He also cares about conforming you to his image. And you don't do that by growing up as a spoiled brat. And God doesn't want any spoiled brats. He wants mature soldiers is what God wants.
Amen.
So, John the Baptist is doing that job. He's making soldiers too. He says, I want you to see him as your commander-in-chief. I'm taking a step away. I must decrease. He must increase. Verse 7. And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, what went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? Is that what you went out to see? Well, what's a reed shaken in the wind? Well, any place where there is natural waterways, there's these marginal plants, and a lot of those are reeds. Now, we have cattails, but there they would have other types of plants that are real tall. Obviously, you go farther south and you get, you know, papyrus that grows in Egypt and so on. There's a lot of these types of sedges and things that grow along the sides. And if you go there, what do you see? Oh, the wind blows and they're all over here. The wind blows and it's all over there. It's just, wherever direction is going, that's where it's going. And it's really making a big show of what the wind is doing. Is that what John the Baptist has done? Is he making a big show of how he's feeling? Or where the tide of teaching is? Or what culture feels like right now? No, that's not him. That's not him at all. He's not a reed shaken in the wind. But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in king's houses. Is that what you went to see? Somebody who's royalty? Somebody who's a prince of the King of Kings? Somebody who's a prince or a princess? Somebody who's dressed? Somebody who's got the best of everything? Somebody who just proclaims into being because he's deserving of the best because he belongs to God? Is this what you went to go see? Well, it's a connection with King Herod. King Herod is somewhat, I mean, I'm not telling anybody that I like the Passion of the Christ movie, but they portrayed Herod a pretty good way. He was kind of effeminate. He had these really soft, silky kind of clothes. That's what this Herod was like.
Funny you mentioned that word effeminate. Somebody mentioned that to me just the other day. Said he wouldn't. His ministry is anti-effeminate.
Yeah.
Not gay.
So, wearing soft clothing. Well, if you had the best of everything, why wear something that could possibly be scratchy? Why wear something that, after a short period of time, it's no longer comfortable? Now, go to any one of our closets, and there's so much clothes that we don't want to do with it. We probably should just take 3/4 of it, give it away, because we're not wearing it anyway. I mean, what's the point of having all this stuff? And some of it's pretty, some of it's soft, some of it's nice. No, this is the stuff that kings wear. We're kings in comparison to the culture and the economic system that was going on back there. You had one set of clothes, that's it, sometimes two. I mean, that's the way life was then. That's the way it is for 3/4 of the world right now. We just don't understand. We're so filthy rich. We just think, oh, I just live in this little tiny house. Oh, I can't wear the newest clothes. Oh, and it's all about looking at all these places where people are completely self-absorbed and selfish to spend huge amounts of money on even something as small as a lunch. But they are willing to spend $50 for it because they are worth it. I mean, that's crazy stuff that this world is up to. No, that's not John the Baptist. He wasn't the least bit self-absorbed. He could care less about any of that stuff. Who took him to lunch every day? God the Father took him to lunch. What did God the Father take into lunch? Hey, see that thing? It's a locust. They're pretty tasty, aren't they? Go get that. Here's another one. Here's another one. Here's another one. Hey, look at that. See, follow that bee. See where he goes. John the Baptist would go follow that bee and find out where it was. He said, thank you, Father, for giving me honey. Thank you, Father, for giving me food. The locusts are clean animals. You know, it talks about the clean animals, and some of them are bugs. But it happens to be these little guys. It could be crickets. It could be grasshoppers. That's what John the Baptist was eating. They're clean animals, even though they're crickets. And, you know, they got jumper legs. That's what he ate. And he ate wild honey. He was being supported by God himself. And what did he wear? Camel's hair.
That's scratchy.
Well, it's scratchy, but what's the idea? He wore sackcloth. He wore the gown of someone who's mourning for the dead. Who was John the Baptist mourning for? The death of Israel. Because they are under God's judgment and they're going to die. And he's crying out to God so that they will understand the judgment is coming. And if you're going to, you got to get things right with the Lord, be baptized in his name. Repent and be baptized. It was all about getting things right with the one to whom you must be held to an account for every thought, word, and deed. This is who John the Baptist was, and people took him seriously, hugely seriously. No, he wasn't like one of these soft guys. But what went ye out for to see? A prophet? Yea, and I say unto you, more than a prophet. This is more than just any old prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Jesus is letting us know that John the Baptist's appearance was prophesied by Malachi. That's him. That's amazing. Could you imagine? I mean, the only other guy who is prophesied is Cyrus. These are the people who are prophesied to come, who isn't God, who isn't Messiah. Now, this is an amazing person. It's like, this is who this person is. He's not an ordinary prophet. This is the one who's prophesied to come. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, of course, as he's saying this, the words that he's quoting, he's preparing thy way before thee. It's talking to Messiah. It's a messianic verse talking about the one who's preparing the way for Messiah. He is telling the people he's Messiah, and he's telling that is the one who's preparing my way for me. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Now that's saying a lot. I mean, this isn't just a man who has lived a righteous life. This is the one who has gone beyond everybody else. Now, some of the prophets have brought up people of the past as an example of righteous living, an example of men of faith, like Job, and like Joseph, and like Daniel. Not to mention we have Hebrews 11 that has a huge hall of faith. But he far surpasses them all. He's greater than any of them. And of course, you know, in Matthew chapter 1, there's this huge section of who John is in chapter 4, Matthew chapter 4, it, who says, you know, and the announcement of his birth in Matthew chapter 1. I mean, there's some amazing things of this man. He's greater than anyone else who's ever been born. Any other man that's ever been born, he's greater than them. And then he says, notwithstanding that he is least in the kingdom of heaven, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Now this just turns this whole thing on its ear. Now what does that mean? Now, you could look at it a bunch of different ways. And most of the commentators are basically saying, well, John the Baptist is the last prophet. That's absolutely true. Jesus says that's true. That we have that interpretation from Jesus himself. He is the last prophet. He's not something of the new covenant. He's of the old covenant. And he's the last one. And the last one is saying, this is Jesus. This is Messiah. So they look at it that way. Okay, he's the last prophet of the old covenant. And yes, John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit while he was still in his mother's womb. But it wasn't the filling that we have the moment we place our faith in Jesus Christ in the new covenant. It was being filled with the Holy Spirit like every other prophet, being anointed, the Holy Spirit coming upon. It's the epi, not the infilling of the word, the Greek word in. Every prophet had the Lord come upon him. Well, that happened in the womb of his mother. Could you imagine? It's not like you finally, you know, you grow up and all of a sudden, you know, you're 22 years old and all of a sudden whammo, and you're called to go do something, or maybe you're 7 years old and whammo, or however old Samuel was, or however old Jeremiah was. No, this was much earlier, is when John the Baptist had the Holy Spirit. So that when Mary showed up in the room, at Mary's voice, John the Baptist leaped with joy in his mommy's womb because there's Messiah. Not Mary, but the one in her womb. Amen. And that's, you got to be filled with the Holy Spirit to know that clearly. So he doesn't have the Holy Spirit like the people in the New Covenant. So they think, well, that's what it means. Or knowing and having the realization and the fulfillment of who Messiah is the new covenant, and he was still of the old covenant. That could kind of mean that. Because the one who just eked into heaven because all he did was believe is still greater than John the Baptist. because he's in the new covenant. And I can understand why some of the commentators would say that. But to me, I think it misses the point completely. Because who is least in the kingdom of heaven? Jesus Christ is the least. He came as a slave to all. He came as a servant of all. I mean, yes, we see Jesus as Messiah, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but he is least in the kingdom of heaven. He came and gave himself as a sacrifice. All of the sins of the whole entire world that ever was and ever will be were all placed on that Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, and he died with their sins. Every time that Jesus talked to God, he said, Father, except when he was on the cross, when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because Jesus took our God-forsakenness for us. And absolutely, it was a fulfillment of prophecy from Psalm 22. And it was the first words of Psalm 22. So as soon as he would say that, people who had Psalm 22 memorized would start saying the rest of the words and would see it on a big screen. No, it wasn't a big screen. They would see it right there as Jesus was living through Psalm 22. He was the one who became a curse for us. He who knew no sin. He was made in the image of sinful man. He was tempted in every way that we are, yet without sin. He is the least in the kingdom of heaven. But he became the servant of all, so that many could be saved. So that's my interpretation of this. I really don't think it has anything to do with the dispensations. Because there's going to be a resurrection, and we are going to all eat at the same table, okay? The Old Testament saints and us. We're going to join with the Old Testament saints at that same banquet. So there's no least and greatest at that point there. So I believe he's talking about himself. Verse 12, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if ye will receive it, this is Elias, which was for to come. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. Okay. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. Now this is a difficult verse. And Jesus says those same words, just a little bit different, in Luke 16. So let me read Luke 16:16 real quick. And it's the same illustration, but it's used just a little bit differently. The law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the kingdom of God is preached, and every man presses into it. It's the same Greek words as far as every man presses into it. And here it is, suffereth violence. The violent take it by force. It's the same Greek word, but it's either used in a middle or deponent or passive sense. Now, this is all grammar. But if it's passive, that means it's being done to you. If it's middle, it's something that you are doing for yourself. And so, that's what is the Greek saying? It's the same. The word in Greek can be either deponent or middle or passive.
One pastor said David, he knows too, that it's actually we're taking the where the spiritual heavenlies are, where the spirit of wickedness is. We're taking that by force.
Well, okay. Presses into it is the idea of this is it's our efforts. That's how it gets the translation violent. Because you are, in the middle sense, doing it for yourself, you are using very aggressive form actions to take it. Okay? In the passive sense, it suffereth violence. So what is it? It's hard to exactly tell what this means. But I can see it more in the middle sense, in the middle tense, rather than the passive tense. Because the Luke definitely means that. They're pressing into it. Now, how do you get to heaven? You believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and He rose again from the dead. I mean, it's belief plus nothing. That's how you get saved. That's how you enter the kingdom of God.
You can
the work of right now, the work of God.
You mean business.
Right. The work of God, Jesus says in John 6, is to believe that He is the one that the Father sent. So, there. What are you contending against? You're contending against the lies that exist. You're contending against what is repentance? The Greek word metanoia means what? To change your mind. Well, a turn to 180 degrees is a turnaround. Yes, right. But it also means to change your mind, which means my opinion's wrong, and I believe what you say. That's metanoia. That is, what are you contending against? You're contending the lies that you've always believed. You're contending against the lies you've always been told. You're contending against the one who has blinded you from believing the truth that's right there in front of your eyes.
Love the things you used to hate, you hate the things you used to love.
That's right. That's right. So is it belief plus nothing? Absolutely. Yeah. But through much tribulation do we enter the kingdom of heaven. I mean, this is a difficult life because the entire world system is now against us. The moment we place our faith in Jesus Christ, there's a great big target on us. Shoot at that guy. But also, I also have to say that in the passive tense is within the context of Matthew. Because in the context of Matthew, what is Jesus talking about? He's talking about the context right there is talking about John the Baptist. Where is John the Baptist? He's in the prison under Herod at this moment. And He sent His disciples to make sure they know that's Jesus the Christ. There is persecution against anybody who's preaching the truth. It's always been that way. And here, John the Baptist is a perfect example. From the time John the Baptist taught, there has been violence against the truth of who Jesus is. So, it absolutely, you can translate it, you know, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence. There is persecution against the kingdom of heaven. So it is absolutely true in the context that it's a passive tense. But I don't want to separate from the middle tense because there is effort on our part. It is a war, like you brought up. There is a nonstop spiritual battle. There, you know, Paul says, you take every opinion, idle notion, you take everything and you bind it and you gag it and you throw it at the feet of Jesus for Him to dispose of. You take every thought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. That happens constantly. Every single choice we make, every single thing we want to do, every place we want to go, everything we want to read, everything we want to listen to, all the stuff that we listen to all the time. There is a constant judgment. What is true? What is false? Are we just going to relax and just passively absorb everything that comes our way? No, what does that mean? Well, if you do that, if you're having hand-to-hand combat and you're going to say, oh, I'm just going to passively receive everything that happens, you're a dead man. No, that's not a good soldier. A good soldier is someone who has been strengthened for the battle. It's not a baby who you got to change their diaper. It's not a baby who you got to pat on the head, you're okay. It's not somebody you got to always, you know, give them that positive and encouraging message all the time. Truth is a weapon. And you can't stand by truth passively. You're either actively supporting the truth or you're passively supporting a lie. There is no in between. So all that to say, when Jesus is saying this word, we have to translate it. You understand? We have to translate it. He's saying the words. It's not a problem for him. Passively and middle is the same. So it's kind of a play on words just because the same thing in the Greek is the same. So it means both, in other words. So I just want to make sure. It is very difficult in the Greek, and it's very difficult to understand. I just want to say that there is of other extra-biblical writings of the time using this word, what's found most often is the middle. And so in Luke 16:16, where it says, presses into it, that is the way that Greek word is usually used in the Greek, in this, in Koine. So I just want to say that. So, it suffereth violence. Well, until now, the kingdom of heaven, people are pressing into the kingdom of heaven. So you can translate it that way. It's not wrong. And the violent take it by force. Those who are pressing into the kingdom of heaven get into it. Well, there's a lot of opposition. I mean, people who get saved, most people have a horrible life before they get saved. Now, some people grow up in the church, and they just all of a sudden at some point realize that they're believers. I understand that. But at some point in time, you have to realize, okay, I'm believing this and not something else. So there absolutely is a pressing in. So, I'm not trying to confuse you. I'm just trying to... This is a difficult passage, and what does it actually mean? Well, it means that we are soldiers, and there is a fight going on, and it's a spiritual fight, and it's to the death. The moment we have placed our faith in Jesus Christ, we are the enemies of all of God's enemies. Amen. And they become our enemies. And there's nothing we can do about it.
We got bullseye on us.
Right. Well, what are we going to do? Be nice to our enemies? And they're going to stop bothering us? No. If we are nice and passive to our enemies, what happens? We are going to be used by them to do damage to the kingdom of heaven. And that's what's always happened. And that's what continues to happen. And these weird, crazy church growth movements is, how are you going to do church? How are you going to do mission work without having to suffer persecution? And so they have all these great ways. And that's what we see. And you've got these churches exploding in numbers. And everybody gets a positive and encouraging message. And you're never going to hear about sin. And you're never going to be told that you're going to have to stand before Jesus Christ in the judgment seat of Christ if you're a believer and answer for every thought, word, and deed. Neither are you going to be told that if you're not a believer, you're going to stand before the great white throne and answer for every thought, word, and deed. No, you're just going to be given something nice. How to have a nice life, how to have a nice family, how to be financially secure, all these things that everybody wants in this world. How to leave a legacy. Oh boy, isn't that a good one. Did John the Baptist leave a legacy? No, he had no kids. He died in prison. He had a 6-month ministry. But all the words of truth that he spoke as he was obedient to Jesus Christ continued and continued and continued. And okay, for all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, and if ye will receive it, this is Elias, which is Elijah, which was for to come. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. Jesus is saying, this is Elijah that comes before Messiah. And that's a difficult statement. But he says it again in a few more chapters, because he's going to go with Peter, James, and John up that mountain, and he's going to be transfigured. And as he's transfigured, he's going to be speaking to Moses and Elijah. And when he comes down the mountain, he's going to talk about Elijah has to come first. Well, John the Baptist did come first. And we read in John chapter 1 what? When they said, are you Elijah? And he said, no. He is Elijah to come. He comes in the spirit and the power of Elijah, just as Gabriel told his dad Zacharias. He was and he isn't. Now, I have to tell you about one thing about prophecy.
I'm on the lost.
Yes.
Between John and Jesus, who are we talking about?
Okay. John chapter 1 is talking about who John the Baptist is. The Pharisees asked him, are you Elijah? And he said, no. But Jesus says he is. So what is that? This is how prophecy works. Prophecy is not, here's a prophecy, here's a fulfillment. And I grew up in church and only believed that. Here's a prophecy, and here's how Jesus specifically fulfilled the prophecy. Here is the example of how prophecy really works. Prophecy is pattern. Elijah is to come first. Absolutely. Here is Elijah to come first. It's John the Baptist. Is it reincarnated Elijah? No, it's John the Baptist. He comes in the power of John the Baptist. John the Baptist comes in the power of Elijah. Everything that Elijah did in the apostate tribes of northern Israel, John the Baptist did in Judea, where they were supposed to be all really close to God and they had the temple and everything. He fulfilled that. But it's pattern, not complete fulfillment. There is still another pattern to come, and that's Elijah that comes before Messiah comes. There's going to be two witnesses witnessing in Jerusalem. One of those is going to be Elijah. Jesus says so. But it could also be Elijah's going to be there, and those two witnesses are just two other witnesses. But it says, in the Greek, it says, the witnesses of mine. In the Greek, it's basically saying, these are people who have already witnessed to me, is basically what the Greek is saying. They're witnesses who have already witnessed. And because Jesus was speaking to Moses and Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration, I personally believe the two witnesses are going to be Moses and Elijah. If you look at what Moses and Elijah, if you do see what the two witnesses do,
yes,
at their will, what do? They do the same things that Moses did, the same things Elijah did. So that's my personal opinion, and if you can believe something else, it's fine. If you look at the references in Revelation, it's referencing two other men. Zerubbabel and Joshua. That's who it's referencing. So, who are these two men? Is it Zerubbabel and Joshua? Maybe God's going to do that. Because that's the quote that there where it comes from. That's where the...
Where Revelation?
When it talks about the two witnesses.
11.
Does it mention when, their names in Revelation?
No, it just says these are the two... These are the olive trees.
Two olive trees.
And it goes... It's a direct quotation from Zechariah, which is talking about Zerubbabel and Joshua.
Okay.
So, all that to say. Anyway, if you're good and confused now, that's fine. Okay. I've made it as clear as mud. All right. But I don't care. It doesn't matter. I just think it's going to be Moses and Elijah. But I think at least one of them is Elijah just because... Yeah. And if I'm wrong, I'll change my view, you know. So, okay.
Well, I didn't believe it was Enoch.
Well, right, because the point of for man once...
never died.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
See,
right.
I'm not somebody...
That was Sharon's
car.
Yeah,
it
was.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Verse. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought I might have been smart.
Oh.
No, it's a funny joke, but we all know.
Okay, verse 16. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets, calling unto their fellows, and saying, "We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he hath a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners, but wisdom is justified in her children." Okay, so now he's saying, he's got a parable here that he's giving. And it's an illustration of what that generation was like, who was there, who John the Baptist was preaching to, and who Jesus is preaching to. And it's not much different than our generation, than our culture either. He says, it's just like kids playing in the marketplace, playing in the streets. I mean, kids always play in the streets because it's a nice big open area there, and you always got to get, you know, pull your ball out of the way so the car doesn't hit it. I mean, that's the way it always is. So they're not playing ball. What are they doing? They're playing, we're going to have a make-believe game. Okay, we're all going to play wedding. Oh, and everybody's laughing and, oh, okay, you don't want to play... Okay, we're all going to play funeral. Okay, oh, we're all going to go and we're all going to cry. That's basically saying, okay, they're playing this game. And everybody's going to follow along and play this game. Except John the Baptist shows up. He don't want to play. He's not in religion to play. He's not going to play that. He's taking things seriously. He knows he stands before God and has to answer. He knows that he is a prophet of God, and he's going to say those words that God had him say, and he's going to be faithful to the end, regardless of the consequences. He's not going to play. They couldn't get John the Baptist to be nice with Herod. They couldn't get John the Baptist to be nice with the Pharisees. They couldn't get John the Baptist to be nice with the Sadducees or any other, none of the Jewish leadership. He wouldn't play their games. He wouldn't dance with the songs that they're playing. He wouldn't do any of that. And so what did they say? Oh, he's demon-possessed. He's crazy. Don't you know that this is the religious leadership? These are God's shepherds. And you're not coming under their authority? What's the matter? You some kind of renegade out there? He wouldn't do it. And they said, oh, he's got a demon. Because he wouldn't be under their authority. Their problem was they weren't under the authority of God. They were doing their own thing. They were taking advantage of God's people. They had a nice thing going. We have piped unto you and you have not danced. We have mourned unto you and have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, they say he hath a devil. Yeah, he didn't share any meal with anybody. He went to the food God had him eat, which was locusts and wild honey. There was nothing fancy about his life. God was supporting him, and he ate what God wanted him to eat, and he wasn't going to eat anything else. And he wasn't going to show fellowship with someone who he was not in fellowship with. He segregated himself out in the wilderness, and he was preaching out in the wilderness, and people came from the whole joint everywhere. 50 miles to come to listen to him.
Yeah, he didn't go looking for some demographic.
Yeah. He's not going to, do a demographic survey of the neighborhood and say, okay, this is a neighborhood I want to pastor because they got the lifestyle that I want to live. Mm-hmm. Or they're just like me. And I want to find out from them what they think a church should do. So you take the survey and you write it all down and you build them what they think a church is, and you build it for them, and they'll come. And then they start giving you money. What that makes you what? A hireling, doesn't it? And you're not leading, they are leading. You're a follower in order to get their money. And you're giving them everything that they want, and they're telling them everything they want to hear. John the Baptist won't do that.
They see you as a leader, and so do the other leaders see you as leaders.
Right.
What a lie that has become.
Oh, yeah. So that's not John the Baptist. He didn't make too many friends. Made lots of enemies. He had enemies in high places. That's why he's in prison right now. And the Son of Man, now when Jesus uses that term, that's a messianic title. It comes directly out of Daniel. Son of Man. And we talked about that. Jesus has to be the Son of Man in order to be the kinsman redeemer. He has to redeem us. But in order to be Redeemer, he has to be just like
human.
Us. He's got to be human. He can't be the Archangel Michael because he ain't human. He can't redeem anybody. But Jesus is not only, he's a Goel. But he's not just the kinsman Redeemer as Redeemer. He's also what the Goel does, which is what? Blood Avenger. He comes first as Redeemer, Goel. Kinsman Redeemer. He redeems us with his own lifeblood. And he comes back as Goel, Blood Avenger. And he has crushed the winepress alone. And he's splattered with the blood of his enemies. And he goes up the Mount of Olives at victory ascent, and it splits in two because creation itself knows he's creator. Now everything changes at that point. Okay. Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber. Jesus shows up, and he's not out there fasting or eating whatever crickets and grasshoppers show up and eating wild honey and fighting off the bees. He's eating with everybody else. He is absolutely the Son of Man, and he's sharing meals with people. He's sharing his life with people. That's exactly who Messiah is. He comes eating and drinking. They say, behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber. They see him eating and they automatically assume he's overeating and he's abusing the food and he's a glutton. He's drinking some wine. Well, what was his first miracle? He turned the water into wine. He says, "Ah, look at that! He's a wino. He's a wine bibber. He's an alcoholic, just because he was drinking some wine." And then it says, "A friend of publicans and sinners." This word for friend is like a close associate, which means he has so identified himself with sinners and tax collectors that they would accept him as his own. He is accused of being a friend of sinners. Praise God. I need a friend because I'm a sinner. And he is my friend. He is my sin. He is not a sinner, but he took my sin. He took 100% identity in me, yet he did not sin. And he was tempted in every way that I am, yet without sin. He was made in the likeness of me, sinful man. Yet he didn't sin. That's the Son of Man. That's what he came to be. And then it says, but wisdom is justified in her children. Wisdom is justified in her children. And that's just a quote. It's like a proverb. Well, in other words, look at the results. Look at how things have finally come to fruition. Look how things have finally been completed. You're making this wrong judgment against John the Baptist. You're making this wrong judgment against Jesus Christ. But look how it's going to end. Look at the fruit. So that's the idea of wisdom being justified. He doesn't have to vindicate himself. His words and his actions have vindicated him. And that's in the context of Jesus sending John the Baptist's disciples back with an amazing learning experience. Everything that Jesus did is what only Messiah can do. Everything that Jesus said is exactly what Messiah would say as he taught the poor. It's amazing. Wisdom is justified of her children. What is the fruit? What is the children of our lives? It shows the reality of who we really are. Well, when you got somebody like John the Baptist, you see the results. Got somebody like Jesus Christ, you see the results. We're out of time, so I'll have to end here, but let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you showed John the Baptist Messiah's, you showed John the Baptist disciples that you are the Messiah. And you show us again that you are Messiah. Thank you, Lord, for basically justifying the existence of John the Baptist. And Lord, we need the example of this man today. Lord, we ask that you help us, Lord. There's never been a man born of woman like that. Lord, there's so many things in our life that have compromised the truth. And people see it. And unbelievers that we know have held us accountable to that. We ask you, Lord, that you bring us to repentance in things that we do, things that we say, things that we might just call bad habits or weaknesses that have compromised the truth of what you've sent us to do and say. Lord, our little stints of frustration because we have been offended because you didn't meet our expectations. Our little times of doing things the easy way and just wanted to tell people what they wanted to hear instead of telling them what you wanted them to know. Those little times where we just allowed sin to go on and we didn't do anything about it. Those times where people were completely lost in the lie that they believed and we didn't use that as an opportunity to share with them what the real truth was. Lord, we're not John the Baptist, and we're not even close. We ask you, Lord, that you bring us to repentance, dear God, that we can speak forth your word, and that we can act out the truth, being obedient to all the truth that we know right in front of them, Lord, so that they're going to know that we really believe what we say we believe. or we're sinners, and we're not good at being prophets. But we ask you, Father, for the power of your Holy Spirit to empower us, especially when we are interacting with those who don't believe in you. But they're going to know that we know who you are and that we believe it, even if it means loss, imprisonment, or death. And Lord, we lift up to you the folks right now, like we're in Iraq and other places, who are they're in a place where they're going to lose their life because they love you. They're not going to compromise on the truth. They're being told to convert to Islam, pay the fine, or die. Or move. And Lord, we ask you for amazing amount of strength. Empower them with your Holy Spirit right now, dear God. Lord, speak to their hearts. Strengthen them. And Lord, we ask that you keep your promise and give them the words in that hour that they need to speak. In that hour. So that not just by their death are they going to give you glory, but by the words of their mouth, it will be such a testimony that their persecutors will never get that out of their mind. And they will turn those persecutors, just like Saul, into the Apostle Paul, spreading forth your God, spreading forth your gospel, regardless of the consequences. Lord, we ask that you give us that kind of power, Lord, to be able to be good soldiers and take the beating in this world. You took the greatest beating for us. And we were responsible for the beating you took. Lord, what's the least that we can do for you, dear Lord, for what you did for us? And Lord, we also lift up to you folks like Daniel's son and others who walked away. You didn't meet their expectations. They're still angry at you because something that they dearly wanted, you said no. Some way they weren't protected. Some way they were taken advantage of. So they didn't want to serve a God who wouldn't give them what they wanted. Lord, we ask that you move upon them with your Holy Spirit. You put people in their life who they are going to listen to. You work out the circumstances and situations in their life to come face to face with the truth of who you are, dear God, and bring them to repentance, Lord. While there's still time, dear God. And Lord, there's all these churches that we're just heartbroken over, places we used to go, and folks that we've been associated with who are offended by your truth and are doing things the world's way. And are trying to build their own church and getting people to love the church, but they've already lost their first love and the lampstand's already been removed. Lord, bring them to repentance, dear Lord. Lord, while there's still time, before you send the judgment against those who don't love the truth, then they won't be saved. So we ask you, Lord, that you intercede. And Lord, give us a heart for them the same way that you've got a heart for them, Lord. You're not willing for any to perish, but all to come to repentance. You want all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Lord, give us that heart. Lord, with your heart in us, we will fast and pray. Lord, with your heart in us, we will speak the truth regardless of the consequences. Lord, with your Holy Spirit in us, there is nothing that you can't accomplish through our lives. Lord, we ask you help us, dear God. In Jesus' name, amen.